dealing this week with a portion of the life of Christ. And I'm dealing with the first four chapters of the Gospel of Matthew. And just by the way of review, I said to you on yesterday morning and day before yesterday that Matthew is a kingdom gospel. It's a kingdom book. And of course it surrounds the king and his kingdom, the subjects of the kingdom. I said to you that there are six major discourses in Matthew. Chapter 5 through 7 is the Sermon on the Mount, commonly called the Beatitudes. These are the laws and the precepts or the constitution that's going to govern the kingdom that is going to be set up. Then the second discourse is in chapter 10, where Jesus charges the apostles. The third discourse is in chapter 13. Chapter 13 deals with the prophetic parables of the kingdom. Now these parables, prophetic parables, deal with the kingdom and they give to us a panoramic history of Christendom. The seven churches in Revelation 2 and 3 give to us a panoramic history of the church age, beginning with the church at Ephesus and going to the church of the Laodiceans. And you'll never know much about the Gospel of Matthew until you get settled on Matthew 13. Just like whenever you go to a bookstore and you pick up a book on Revelation, if you'll read what the man has to say about the rider of the white horse in Revelation 6, it'll color the rest of the book, what he believes about it. And on and on and on. But these seven churches give to us a panoramic history of the church age. And then there's another discourse, major discourse, and this is found in chapter number 18. And this is the discourse on the called the Lesson on Forgiveness. And then there's another major discourse, and this is found in chapter 23, where Jesus denounces the Pharisees and the Sadducees. They paraded around in the marketplaces, said long prayers, were seen of men, put on a 45 RPM and played it over and over and over again. And Jesus said, God doesn't start with the outside and work in, but he starts with the inside and works out. He said, on the outside, you look like a whited tombstone, but on the outside, but on the inside, you're full of dead men's bones. You're a crowd of touch not, taste not, and handle not. And when those people were traveling in those days, if they came upon a white sepulcher tombstone out in a field, they knew not to touch that tombstone. They believed that the person that had died and was buried there had died with some incurable disease. And so they went in another route if they spotted a white tombstone. And they believed that if they touched that tombstone, they would contact the same disease and die of the same disease. And the Pharisees, they were touch not, taste not, and handle not. Inside, they were full of dead men's bones. Outside, they were like that tombstone. The next and last major discourse is the Olivet Discourse. This, of course, is in Matthew 24 and 25. Now, the rapture of the church takes place before Matthew 24. And in Matthew 24, we have the great tribulation. We have the abomination of desolation spoken of by Daniel the prophet. In Matthew 25, there are three parables, and these three parables relate to the kingdom or the second advent of Christ. There's the parable of the wise and foolish virgins. And by the way, I don't believe they were women. I'll try to show you that today. In Revelation 14, there's a group of men that are seen on Mount Zion who are virgins, who have not defiled themselves with women. By the way, the bride is not mentioned in that passage. The church. Then there's a parable of the talents. Parable of the talents has to do with the believer or with Christians. And of course, it's relative to from the time of the ascension to the rapture. The third parable is the parable of the sheep and the goats. There's another group called the brethren. This parable has to do with Israel only. And this is the only parable that Jesus refers to himself as a king in. The parable of the virgins speak of the consummation of the Jews. The emphasis is upon light. Jesus is referred to as the Son of Man. In the parable of the talents, gives to us a picture of the consummation of the church. The emphasis is upon loyalty. And of course, Jesus is presented as Lord. Then there is the parable of the sheep and the goats, nations, by the way. This gives to us a picture of the consummation of the nations. The emphasis is life. And of course, Jesus is presented as King. So that is the last major discourse in the Gospel of Matthew. Now, in chapter 1, we have the background of the King. In chapter number 2, we have the birth of the King. That's what we dealt with on yesterday morning. There are only two accounts of the virgin birth of Jesus in the Gospels. One is found in the first chapter of Matthew, the second chapter of Matthew, verse 18 through 25 of chapter 1. And then in Luke chapter number 1, verse 26 through 35. And so we find that God's law always requires two witnesses. And of course, that's why you only have two accounts of the virgin birth. Two times God said, "This is my beloved Son." Two witnesses talked to the Lord about his death on the cross. There were two witnesses at the tomb. Of course, witnessed his death and resurrection. There are two witnesses that are witnesses coming again. Two gospel witnesses concerning his humanity. Two gospel witnesses concerning his deity. And then there is the law and the prophet. So you see, there are only two accounts of the virgin birth, the birth of the King. Now this morning, we're dealing with chapter number 3, and we're dealing with the baptism of the King. Now, in chapter number 3, the first part deals with John the Baptist, who came as the herald of the King. Now, if I read the Old Testament correctly, in Isaiah chapter 40, verse 3 and 4, heralds always preceded monarchs that announced their coming. So it was with the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. John heralded the coming of the Messiah. The voice of the Old Testament prophecy from Malachi to Matthew had been silent for 400 years. The last note that is revealed in Malachi is, "Behold, I will send you Elijah." And one other prophet says, "Before the great and notable and dreadful day of the Lord." Elijah is probably one of the two witnesses. We believe that's true since Israel rejected Christ as their Messiah. I might just stop here and toss out a deep supposition. Just suppose Israel had have received Jesus as their Messiah. They would have put him on the throne, took him off of the throne, fulfilling Old Testament prophecy, took him off of the throne, crucified him on a cross. Then, of course, he would have been raised from the dead, ascended back, of course, to the Father. And the tribulation would have begun at the cutting off of the prince, Daniel's 70th week. Then at the end of 7 years, he would have come back to this earth again in what is called the second advent. Now we're living in the gap between the 69th and the 70th week of Daniel. The 69th week of Daniel officially came to a close with the cutting off of the prince. And that undetermined amount of days between the 69th and the 70th week of Daniel is the church age, not the kingdom age. And so the last word of revelation in the Old Testament until Matthew was, "Behold, I will send you Elijah the prophet." But the New Testament opens with a revelation, "Behold, the Lamb of God that taketh away the sin of the world." Now, when chapter number 3 opens, we have Jesus is at least 30 years of age. Mr. Josephus, who was the brother of Nicodemus, Josephus said, "I never embraced Christianity." He said, "My brother Nicodemus embraced Christianity." He said, "I embraced Phariseeism, the religion of the Pharisees, because I felt it was closest to the truth at that time." Of course, a lot of people do that today, and they miss Christ. And so we see that Jesus was 30 years old. And Josephus says, whenever John the baptizer, and that's what the word Baptist means, Jesus was 30 years old, about to enter his public ministry. Now let me stop here and say, he says that there, when John the Baptist, that leather-lunged Baptist preacher, stepped on the banks of the River Jordan and declared, "Behold the Lamb of God that taketh away the sin of the world," he said that there were at least 13 different Johns of preaching. At the same time, John was a preaching, but John was the only one that baptized. Now, Jesus was 30 years old. In verse number 1, and I won't read the scripture. You know the scripture as well as I do, and I'll deal with it as we go along this morning. But in those days tells us something. That is, it simply tells us that Joseph and Mary were dwelling in the little village of Nazareth. And now Jesus is 30 years of age. Now, when a Jewish boy was 6 years old, and that's where we get sending our kids to school beginning when they're 6. When a Jewish boy was 6 years of age, they sent him to what was called the house of the book. And he stayed in the house of the book until he was 12 years of age. Then at the age of 12, he entered what was called the school of the law. And he stayed in the school of the law until he was 18 years of age. Then he finished the school of the law. He was expected to be married by the time he was 21 years of age. But if he entered the rabbinical school to train for a rabbi, he had to wait until he was 30 years of age. Now Nicodemus was right in John 3 when he said, "Rabbi, we know thou art a teacher come from God." He was a rabbi. So Jesus entered his public ministry at the age of 30, the same time the rabbis would enter the rabbinical school of the day. All right, now let's apply that to Matthew 11:28. It says, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and take my yoke upon you and learn of me. And then it says, and ye shall find rest unto your souls. Now that's not a yoke that you put on oxen at all. But that yoke that Jesus is talking about in that verse is a yoke of obedience that the rabbis took upon themselves the day they entered the rabbinical school at the age of 30, and the day that Jesus, at the age of 30, entered his public ministry as a rabbi, he took upon himself the yoke of obedience to do the will of his Father. I said to you yesterday that Jesus had a human body, he had a human soul, he had a human spirit, he had a human nature, he had the nature of God, he was one personality, but he only had one will. And that was to do the will of the Father. And that was the yoke of obedience that he took upon himself. Now that ought to help you a little bit. Now, it says in the second part of that first verse, it says, in those days came John. John means a gift from God. You ought to give your children decent names. Don't name your children after that Hollywood crowd of queers and prostitutes and lesbians. Every Bible name, as I mentioned to you, means something in the Word of God. Isaiah means salvation is of the Lord. Joseph means dad too. Methuselah means when he dies, it shall be sent. Noah means rest. Enoch means to be translated. And on and on and on through the Bible. John means a gift from God, and he was that. And I'll try to help you with that. And just, it says, came John the baptizer preaching in the wilderness of Judea, saying, repent ye, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Now, John the Baptist was a baptizer. That's what the word Baptist means. Now, I'm not a Baptist because John was a Baptist. Now, I want to tell you straight from the shoulder, I ain't no Baptist brother. I preached a meeting a while back in Kentucky, and there were 43 preachers sitting there, and 40 of them were Baptist brothers, and 3 of them, believed what I was a preaching, and managed like plowing in a new ground. I didn't know what was wrong. I mean, I run slam into stuff. Now, you don't have Baptists until about 1640. A man by the name of Wright and Roger Williams came to Rhode Island, established the First Baptist Church. You know why they did? They believed in the individual priesthood of every believer. I believe that. They believed in separation of church and state. I believe that. They believed in the autonomy of the local church. No organization, no denomination, no religious body has the right to tell another religious body what they can do or what they cannot do under God. Not a Baptist brother. I'm not a hard-shell Baptist either. All people accuse me of being a hyper-Calvinist. I ain't no hyper-Calvinist. I don't agree with that crap. I don't want to be labeled it. Well, that crowd don't know what the filling of the Spirit of God is, and they don't know what practical holiness of life is. They don't know what separation is. I know a Baptist preacher right now got 6 cans of beer sitting in his refrigerator passing the church, not less than 100 miles from here, got an old long beard sitting around doing nothing, smoking a cigar. I might just say this, in case the rabbit, anything that'll keep you from having compassion and a concern for lost men, well, it may be a doctrine in the Bible, but it's a perverted doctrine. I'll tell you something else, Ryan. I ain't no brethren either. And I ain't no Presbyterian, I'm a Baptist. Sometimes they make me ashamed of myself. That crowd that way far makes me ashamed a lot of times, but I'm still a Baptist.
Amen.
Yeah, man. make you mad too if they put a sign out on the co-ed building and say to hell with Baptist. That's what they did. I wouldn't give a dime of my money if hell froze over.
That's right.
Watch it.
That's good.
It says that he came preaching, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is an heir. He's alive to the Old Testament prophet, but his ministry is recorded in the New Testament. Now his preaching was kingdom preaching, and his baptism was kingdom baptism, and his message was kingdom message. All right, look over here, if you will, just a little farther. Notice in verse number 11, it says, I indeed baptize you with water unto repentance. It says, but he that cometh after me is mightier than I, whose shoes I'm not worthy to bear. He shall baptize you with Holy Ghost and with fire. We don't baptize unto repentance. We baptize because me and I have repented and exercised faith in Jesus Christ. Is that right?
That's right.
Now this message of the kingdom was preached by John. The Lord Jesus preached the same message. In Matthew chapter 4, verse 23, and the 12 that were sent out, they preached the same message. Message of the kingdom. Now, the kingdom appears in three forms in the Gospel of Matthew. The kingdom was first preached by Jesus, our Lord, and then the 12 preached the kingdom of heaven is at hand, and there is no doubt, that so that there would be no doubt that the Jewish hearers would know that the reference was to the promise that God had made to David in 2 Samuel chapter 7, verse 14 through 16. Then the kingdom came in its mystery. That's the second form of the kingdom in Matthew. The Jews would not receive the Lord Jesus as their Messiah, and so the kingdom predicted by the prophets had been to be postponed. The mysteries revealed the existence of a blend of good and evil all through the interval between the rejection of the king and the kingdom and its official setting up, according to the prophetic word, which will come in the future. The third form of the kingdom, of course, is shown once again, this time in its future glory, in Matthew chapter number 17. And then in chapter 24 and 25, Jesus predicts that he is coming in power and glory to set up that kingdom which the prophets foretold and prophesied about in the Old Testament. Should we preach repentance? We're to preach repentance toward God and faith in Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Old John Calvin said, a man will never walk the streets of glory until he's genuinely repentant. Now, what is the difference between the gospel of the grace of God and the gospel of the kingdom? I don't know why Baptist preachers hate the gospel of the grace of God like they do. But they do. Now there's a vast difference between what John preached and what you're to preach today. In fact, the same message that John the Baptist preached, repeat, for the king is at hand. That's what the kingdom of heaven means. The king is among you, receive him, he's your Messiah. He's a redeemer, he's your savior. You see? Now, during the tribulation, we believe that when these 144,000 go to the ends of the earth, they'll not be preaching the gospel of the grace of God, but they'll be preaching that same message, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Now, God has never changed his way of salvation. I read a book just this morning. He said in the Old Testament, God saved people by works. No, Abraham was justified by faith. And then when he offered his son on Mount Moriah, that only son, that son whose name means joy bringer, when he offered that son, that proved his faith. contradiction between James and Paul, by the way. Paul is looking at it from God to man. James is looking at it from man to God. James says, show me your works, so believe you got saved. Paul says, the man's justified before God, apart from any works whatsoever. Now the gospel, I want you to listen to this. God help me with this thing. The gospel of the grace of God and the gospel of the kingdom. The gospel of the grace of God calls us to salvation and oneness with Christ. I am the vine, ye are the branches. Can't separate the head from the body. The gospel of the kingdom calls men to salvation only. Not the oneness in Christ. The gospel of the grace of God calls us to be children in the family of God. The gospel of the kingdom calls men to be only subjects of the kingdom. The gospel of the grace of God commands us to believe in the finished work of Christ and rely upon the risen Lord to keep us unto the end. The gospel of the kingdom calls upon men to show their faith in God by their works and to endure to the end. He that endures to the end, the same shall be saved. There it is. Wouldn't be good if a Pentecostal Church of God and a Free Will Baptist would learn the meaning of that verse, wouldn't they? The gospel of the grace of God offers us a robe of righteousness, which never needs any washing. The gospel of the kingdom requires men to wash their robes and make them white in the blood of the Lamb. Revelation 7. The gospel of the grace of God teaches us to look for Christ to come and take us unto himself. The gospel of the kingdom teaches us to look for Christ to come in manifested glory to deliver Israel or them in the time of extremity and in the time of trouble. The gospel of the grace of God makes believers a called out body which is the church. The gospel of the grace of the kingdom makes men subjects of the kingdom, called the kingdom of heaven. In the gospel of the grace of God, we are invited to come for all things are now ready. The gospel of the kingdom, they are called to flee from the wrath of God to come. And that in Matthew chapter 3 is in reference to the tribulation. The gospel of the grace of God says, repent and receive Christ, and you will be taken up to meet him and to be with him forever. The gospel of the kingdom says, repent and receive Christ, and you will enter into his kingdom when it is set up. Now, a wonderful brother Lincoln was right last night. I hear a preacher say, now you come down the aisle and receive Jesus, and God will give you a new heart. That just ain't so. It may make good preaching, but that ain't so. God is going to give Israel a new heart. He's going to give the believer a new body. Now, I heard a man say, what I started to say a while ago, he said that God changes his way of salvation. I want to say this to you. God is always saying, me and my grace through faith, I push nothing and minus nothing. There is only one gospel. You hear what I'm saying? It's not four gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, but it's the gospel according to Matthew, the gospel according to Mark, the gospel according to Luke, the gospel according to John. There is only one gospel. Yet there are different features of that gospel in different ages. Fundamentally, they are the same gospel. Salvation by grace through faith. But they show that there are different administrations of the gospel according to God's dispensational plans and purposes. There are four forms of the gospel. Talk about in the Word of God, there's the gospel of the kingdom. That is the good news that God purposes to set up on this earth in fulfillment to the Davidic covenant, a kingdom politically, spiritually, Israelite, universal,
1,000 years. Now, the four Gospels do not give us... Now, don't you call me a heretic. Now, you better study what I'm saying at least 15 minutes, because I've studied it at least 15 minutes. The four Gospels. Now, you're telling me I'm a God. How many times is the word church mentioned in the Gospel? Two times. Matthew 16 and Matthew 18. Matthew 16 is a future reference. Upon this rock, I will build my church. And that's the only thing Jesus ever called his own, is a church. Now, the four Gospels do not give a straightforward explanation of the plan of salvation as they are an historical account of the Savior and his work by which salvation has been made possible. If you want an explanation of the plan of salvation, you're going to have to go to the epistles to get it. Now smoke that in your pocket. The second form of the gospel is the gospel of the grace of God. And the gospel of the grace of God is the good news that Jesus Christ is now the rejected King, and he died on the cross for the sins of the world, and that he was raised again for our justification, and by him all that believe in him are justified from all things. The gospel of the grace of God, isn't it? And then there's the everlasting gospel. The everlasting gospel is the good news preached to earth dwellers at the very end of the tribulation, and of course precedes the judgment of the nation. And then of course the last one of the gospel is my gospel. Paul calls it my gospel, and the reason that he calls it my gospel is because this is the fullest development of the gospel of the grace of God. It includes the revelation of the results of that gospel in the calling out of the church, in her relationship, her position, her privileges, and her responsibilities to the risen Christ. You need to get straight on this gospel. Boy, I've never met so many legalized preachers. Everywhere I go, ever fellowship meeting I go to, you got to cross your teeth, got your eyes, you got to preach on smoking cigars and wearing shorts and slacks and pants. I'm against all these things. I like chicken. I've got all I like to bring me over today. You get everybody in your church converted from watching television, what you going to preach? Take you a while to get everybody converted from watching television, but what you going to preach when you do? Something else it says about John. It says that John came in the power and in the spirit of Elijah. Now in Matthew chapter 11, it's plain and plain. Jesus said that Elijah's already here. Said if you Jews would have received John the Baptist and received me, the King and the kingdom of the King, then John the Baptist would have been the fulfillment of that prophecy. In Malachi 4, when he says, behold, I will send my servant Elijah, but they rejected him, so therefore Elijah has to be one of the two witnesses, and Enoch is not the other one. I'll tell you who the other one is. It's John the Revelator. If you don't believe it, you read Revelation 10, Revelation 11, and apply all those personal pronouns. He must prophesy again. He must prophesy again before many tongues and nations and so on and so forth. There's nothing wrong in having an Old Testament witness and a New Testament witness. I forget your theology because you read it in Laman Strauss's book. You know, under God, I wish we had some preachers do some thinking for themselves.
Amen.
And I'm just thinking in the Old Testament, in the Old Testament, it was Ahab and Jezebel after the head of Elijah. But in the New Testament, it was Herod and Herodias after the head of John the Baptist, who came in the power and in the spirit of Elijah. Another thing about John the Baptist was a humble man. He said, he must increase and I must decrease. He said, I'm a boy. Most of us are just echoes. In John chapter 3, verse 29, Jesus takes his place with the Old Testament saints. He said, he that standeth on the outside rejoices to know he that hath the bride is the bridegroom. That's the best man. At a marriage, you have a bride, the bridegroom, the best man. And so the church is the bride, the bridegroom is Christ. And Israel is the best man at the marriage supper of the Lamb. The marriage of the Lamb is heaven. Let me briefly deal with this for just a second. The bride always wore a veil. She was engaged. She never could take that veil off. Boy, that means she was spoken. I wish I had time to do a little TNT superficial. But I don't have time to do it. But she was given a veil from the time she was engaged till the time she got married, and she was not to take that veil off in public. And maybe there's a young man who just caught that young lady's eye going down the street, and he doesn't know her, he doesn't know her family, he doesn't know anything about her, but he's got a best friend. And one day they're talking, he said, hey, do you know so-and-so? I've lived over yonder across the other hill. He's the best guy. His best friend said, sure, I know my family. He said, do you know that family dog? Oh, yeah, I'm full of women. Said, what does she look like? Oh, he said, I've seen her many times. I said, she's beautiful. And he said, you know, I'd like you to set up a date with her. So every date that they have, that best friend has to go with the bridegroom, I'm saying it like this, to be, to court that girl. And he sits between that bride-to-be and the bridegroom. And the conversation is always to the best friend. You can't talk to him directly. But you talk to the best friend of the bridegroom-to-be, and the bridegroom talks to the best friend, and he talks to the bride. And then there is the engagement, and then finally there's the wedding. Two things about that Jewish wedding. Number one, the wedding always takes place in the father's house. Number two, the bride never knows the time of the wedding. All right, now, the day of the wedding, the best man or the best friend of that bridegroom has now become the best friend of that bride-to-be. He goes to the marriage hall. Still got that veil on, and that bridegroom is never seen. And then after the wedding ceremony is over, the best friend, the best man, leads that bride and the bridegroom to the bridal chamber. Then the bridegroom takes the bride into the bridal chamber and shuts the door, and the best friend or the best man stands on the outside of the door and puts his ear to the door. And then the bridegroom faces his bride, and he lifts that veil up off of the face of his bride, and the bridegroom says, wow. And then the best man, the best friend on the outside of that door is listening, and he hears that bridegroom say, wow. And he just says, hallelujah, glory to God. Now the Holy Ghost is our best man. He's a friend. He's our friend. One of these days, the Lord Jesus Christ is going to come back from heaven above. He's going to come after his bride. Going to the marriage of the Lamb. We're going to be married in the Father's house. And on the closed day and on the closed time. And then after the marriage of the Lamb, we're going to come back to Jerusalem. is not going to come to the Mount of Olives like you fellas have been preaching. He's going to come to Sinai. Then he's going to take the route of the King's Highway, the route of the Ark of the Covenant. He's going to go down to Petra, pick up the 10 virgins that are represented in that remnant. And then he's going to cross over the River of Jordan, and then he's going to go to the Mount of Olives. And they'll look on him whom they have pierced, and they'll weep and wail and mourn for him, and a nation shall be born in that day. I imagine whenever Jesus, see, he ain't never seen his bride. The Holy Ghost has, but he didn't. And man, whenever he looks upon that bride and he's pregnant with his own blood, for the first time he's going to say, wow! And I believe the Holy Ghost is going to say, hallelujah, glory to God, I see the wonderful God. John was an announcer. Jesus was the one announced. John was the voice. Jesus was the word. John was the forerunner. Jesus was the Lord. John was the herald. Jesus was the person spoken of. John was the testifier, Jesus was the proof. John was the lamp, and Jesus was the light. John was a baptizer in water, but Jesus was a baptizer in the Holy Ghost. John was different from the other person. I heard you read about it. The greatest man born a woman, yet he never performed any miracles. And he never told you to come. Amen. Filled with the Holy Ghost even from his mother's womb. I was on an airplane coming back from Louisville, Kentucky a while back. There was a lady reading some sort of translation of the Bible. And I called the witness and said, what religious affiliation are you? She said, I'm the charismatic Presbyterian. He said, you speak in tongues? I said, no, ma'am, I don't. I'm just trying to take care of the one I got. He said, have you been saved? I said, yes, ma'am, I've been saved. He said, have you been baptized with the Holy Ghost? I said, I think I have. She said, have you been filled with the Holy Ghost? I said, I think I have. She said, you speak in tongues? I said, no, ma'am, I don't. She said, well, you'll make it to heaven, all right. I said, ma'am, that's far as I plan to go. That's far as my ticket costs. Now, folks, there's an order. You know what helps you folks, you preachers? If you learn in the book of Acts that there is a transitional period. The first 11 chapters deal with the life of Peter and his ministry to the Jews. Chapter 12 to 28 deals with the life of Paul and his ministry to the Gentiles. And there are three different orders of salvation in the book of Acts. As the order of salvation for the Jews, repentance and faith, baptism in Jesus' name, and then the reception of the Holy Ghost. Then there's the order for the Samaritans in Acts 8. Repentance and faith, baptism in Jesus' name, laying all of the apostles' hands in verse 8, and then the reception of the Holy Ghost. Then there is the order for the Gentiles, repentance and faith, and of course the reception of the Holy Spirit of God, and then baptism in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. That's the order. John was different. His doctrine was different. His beauty was different. What else had that blessing? Story of Scripture introducing Jesus to the Messiah, to Israel. The man were different. He said, if you want me to baptize these youth, you let me take your water. I think so, that's what I mean. If you notice in verse number 7 of this same chapter, it says, and when he saw many of the Pharisees, now there were only 6,000 Pharisees that ever lived. That's what Joseph Peter said. And it was out of these 6,000 that the Sanhedrin was made up. Some say Sanhedrin. do some things every 2 hours, he's supposed to do something. But anyway, that's where the Sanhedrin came from. They denied the resurrection. They were always sad, you see. So they denied the resurrection. You don't have any real joy. And John said, when he saw them coming to his baptism, he said, "Oh, generation of snakes!" Where in the world did he get that from? Genesis 3:15 said, "You're the seed of the serpent, who had warned you to flee from the wrath of God." John said, "It's a Nehemiah 13 preached on Sunday morning in your church because he's cursed. Nehemiah 13 says, "When I saw the king marrying the daughters of Ashdod and Ammon, he said, 'He made me some man until I smote him on the head. I plucked out the beard and said, I cursed out loud.'" Oh, he said, "I was cursed." Well, I tell you one thing, I fool with Baptists for 30 odd years, and I felt like it a lot of times. I ain't going to hypocrite about it. I'm like the fellow that said, "If you, I never have cursed, but if you'll write it down on a piece of paper, I'll find the name to it." Oh, come on. Don't hypocrite.
That's right.
You're not brave and wicked as hell, just like I am. Yes, the difference is light with difference. John was educated in three ways. First of all, he was educated in the school of the home. There's three things that made this home different from any other home. That is, number one, it was a home that recognized the Lamb of God when he came. Where did he get it from? He got it from old Zechariah. Zechariah testified in John chapter number 1, "I am sure, I bear record that this is the Son of God." It was a home that recognized the Lamb of God. Number two, it was a home of prayer. Luke 1 said, "Zacharias, he said, 'I have heard your prayer, and you're going to be a father. You're going to name that son we've born John, which means the gift of God.'" And then it was a spirit-filled home. Luke 1:15, it says that he shall be filled with the Holy Ghost. It says that he shall drink neither wine nor strong drink. No razor shall ever go on his head. And as a Nazarite, he shall never touch anything that's dead." Now, no razor, no hairspray. That was designed to take the pride out of the man of God. Whenever he walked down the street, that long hair, no razor, no hairdo, or that humble him, that takes a pride. Man of God. I want to tell you, God knows how to take the pride out of us.
Yeah. You ever read about those signs in the Bible, four times the side of faith, side of faith, side of way, side of grace?
All of us have pride. God knows how to take it out. Remind me of a little story that I read one time about a boy got a job at the school. And he worked for about a month or so, and boy, he thought he owned the store. He knew it was the ins and outs. And so one day, the proprietor, the owner of the store, had to go to the bank. And he said, "Sonny boy, you take over while I'm gone. I got to run to the bank. I'll be back in just a little while. You take care of the store." As he left, and the man got in and said, "Hey, Sonny, where's the boss at?" And the man said, or the little boy said to the man, he said, "I'm the big chief around here now." And the man said to the little boy, said, "Well, when your boss gets back, you tell him that I said he's about out of shoes." in something else. He was not to touch anything that was dead. That was designed for his discipline. That's a tough word in our day, discipline. I dealt with that yesterday. But that's why I prayed a man as Zacharias was. And say the woman in Zechariah, as Elizabeth was, John the Baptist couldn't even go to that funeral because of that Nazarite vow.
The home of prayer, the home that recognized the Lamb of God, there was a spirit filled. Some of you preachers ain't gonna never amount to nothing because you're filled with the Spirit of God. And that's apart from regeneration.
That's right.
And this spirit is the spirit of heaven can be had. Genesis 13 says God left those Jacob alone in the place. Place of desperation. You come to a place of desperation. You'll cry. Old Jacob said that angel wrestled with him and passed the night. The last half of the night, he was wrestling with the angel of God, and that's the biggest
flame
up in the Word of God. That angel could have smote him and killed him, and he
would. But he said, I will not let you go until you bless me. The angel said, if I touch it, thou shalt have power with God and power with me. And the next day, after being touched with the angel of God in the sinew, in the flint, in the fireplace, he hobbled over to the nail. But everybody knew that he'd been changed from a Jacob to an Israel priest with God.
Amen. How can be lost? Second
Kings 6 says that going to be on the line, it's going to be on the edge of the school house. For the prophets and priests, the school house got too little for us. The Bible and the seminary got too little.
Know what I said? I didn't want to let you let everybody just get an action. Stop down the tree, be down the tree, build it, put it on the ground.
The ones that were in hell were at, so we go to a little barn.
They go down the woods and start chopping. And years, 4 or 5 weeks, don't get the tree down. And lo and behold, the axe comes off and flies way over there in the far woods. Now that guy had more sense than most of us have. Most of us just stop and look at the axe. He
knew where it fell, he knew where it lost it. He knew how to get it back. He went to the man of God.
And most of the time, when something gets wrong in your life, instead of going to the man of God, you go to somebody that speaks your language and is going to tell you and say to you what you want to hear. He went over and got the ass head back. There was no need to try to cut that tree down when he did that.
Look at the Bible. Look at Luke.
Look at Luke chapter 1. Three people. By the way, did I say that the filling of the Spirit is apart from regeneration? You come to Christ for the filling of the Spirit just like you come to Christ to be saved.
Amen.
Ain't a second blessing, but it's a continual progressive second. It's a continual progressive work of grace.
Yeah.
I will show you how these three people were filled with the Spirit in Luke chapter 1. First of all, it says in verse 13 and verse 15, it says, for he shall be great in the sight of the Lord, and he shall drink neither wine nor strong drink. So it was a separation. That's how John the Baptist was filled with the Spirit of God, a separation. Can't feel the Spirit of God don't hobble off around with car babies. Not the fact that you leave the world, it's the fact that the world just leaves you. That's what happened when I got saved.
So he was filled with the Spirit of God by separation. And then, look down on Elizabeth. Look down in verse 41. She was filled with the Holy Ghost. It says, by taking her rightful position in the hall as a wife and a mother. Mary rose in those days, and she went into the hill country, made haste in the city of Judah, and entered into the house of Zacharias and Elizabeth, the king of Tyre, in the house, and Elizabeth heard the saddest danger, and said, but Mary was in a woman, and Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Ghost. I look out Zacharias, down verse 57, same chapter. Now Elizabeth, full time, was come that she could be delivered, she brought forth a son. And her neighbor came, and her cousin. And they were rejoicing, said hallelujah, about the little baby this born. And look at what else it says in verse number 59. The eighth day they come in, and that's the official day for circumcision, and for the naming of the baby. And they come in on the eighth day, and they say, let's name that baby after his father. Let's name him Zacharias Junior. Oh, there ain't no junior. God already told that old man what to name that young man. God said, old man, you name that young man John. And since old Zacharias was a Jew, and by the way, in the Bible, there are believing unbelievers and there are unbelieving believers. And Zacharias was an unbelieving believer. And he said, now, God, if I'm going to be a dad as old as I am, and Liz was going to be a mama as old as you, how about giving you a sign? He said, okay. And he shut his mouth for 9 months. Couldn't say a word. And here he is. God already told that old man what to sing. And the neighbors come in. And the cousins come in. You know, you can't talk to people for doing the will of God. How many people stay home on Sunday and sit there for ain't see? We're up with God. Somebody else. I don't have any company on Sunday morning. I ain't had no visitors on Sunday morning, Sunday night, Wednesday night, in 35 years. Nobody ever visits me on Sunday morning. I wonder why that is. But the cousins come in and the neighbors come in and they say, hey, that name is Junior, Zacharias Junior. And man alive, that old man's about to have a fit. He said, boy, God was about to explode in his soul. And then they run to that old man and they say, my God, old man, what you trying to do? And they put him alive right in his head and they write one word on that heaven. And instead, he writes the word God, J-O-H-N, on that writing tablet. And when he signs on the dotted line, his mouth is open, his tongue is loose, and he's filled with the Holy Ghost. He's filled with the Holy Ghost by just being obedient. Amen. Stop just doing what God said to you. Now, Samson was a Nazarite.
No raisins, no hair cut.
That was designed to take the pride out of it. Of course, he's not touching anything that was dead. That, was for his discipline, but the strong drink was for his separation. Now, Samson was a Nazarite. Now, I am of the opinion that Jesus was a Nazarene, but not a Nazarite, for if he'd have been a Nazarite, he could have never raised Lazarus from the dead. He couldn't go to a funeral. He couldn't raise Jairus' daughter from the dead, or the widow's son. And so, Samson was a Nazarite. And Samson didn't lose his power to God overnight. But that is just like you lose your power. You start working overtime on Wednesday night. That's when it always happens. Paul Strange comes around about 4:30. Hey, you got a little extra work done. Well, I just bought the new boat, just bought the new car, and I need a little extra money. Yeah, I'll work for that. God may have just given that preacher one word that helped you. Well, you work. And the first thing you know, you start getting out on Sunday night. The next thing you know, you're supposed to ask, well, Samson didn't lose his power of Right. He went down to see his girlfriend one day, and a lion roared out at him. The mighty death. Goes down to see his girlfriend, and all the way down there, a lion that represents the devil roared out at him. You see, David killed the lion with a bear before he ever faced the lion. Most of us have never killed a lion or a bear, and we expect to defeat the lion. He goes down, and on the way, a lion roars out of him, and he tears that lion apart, and he throws him over in the thicket. He goes on down, doesn't live toward and goes back home. The next time he goes down to his girlfriend, he forgets to put on the whole armor of God. And if you forget to put on the whole armor of God, that's the very point the devil sets up a beachhead and defeats you in your Christian experience in life. And so he gets down to where the lion is, and he remembers that the lion roared out against him. And he goes over, and he looks at the carcass of that lion, and he sees the form of Eve. And he reaches in, and he touches that carcass of that dead lion, and he violates and scares the lion of fire. And he goes down the road with a handful of honey. He needs honey from the dead carcass, but he's living in the power of God.
Amen.
The woman, the next step, he's in the temple of St. John. His eyes are gouged out. He's bound and he's grinding in the field. The mighty Satan has lost his power. He goes down into the temple. God let John the Baptist stay in the wilderness for 20 years. John the Baptist is different from most of us. John the Baptist went to school 20 years, and he preached 6 months and got his head cut off. Most of us won't go to school 6 months and expect to preach 20 years. Nothing ever happened to us. God let him stay in that wilderness. In fact, that's one of the places of education. He's educated in the home, educated in the school of the Nazarite vow, and he was educated in the wilderness. Nobody builds a home in a wilderness. No activity in a wilderness. And when God let him stay in that wilderness for 20 long years, he was giving him a picture of a lost world. Showing him a picture of a man out of the will of God. John the Baptist not only had a great education, John the Baptist had a great commission. He's a man sent from God. I got down in Kingsport, Tennessee a while back. In Kingsport, Brother Herman, the chief of surgery, isn't that where he is? Chief of surgery, I was in the chief of surgery. And he said, tomorrow night we're going to take you out to supper.
I said, I'll be fine. I said, well,
he said, why are you just coming out across the street there just from the motel and we'll take you back to take it. And I went over there the next evening, met him at 5, and Ms. Durgill started crying while we had to listen. And I said, what in the world's wrong with you? He said, well, preacher, you're not like the last evangelist we had. And I said, well, what about the last evangelist? And man said he sure wasn't dressed. Well, some of these preachers dressed like they just got out of the Greenland Brothers and Barnum and Bailey Circus. I don't mean that you've got to wear a double-breasted pin-striped suit like Lee Robertson. I know some people, every time Lee Robertson drinks a Pepsi, they burst. I love Lee Robertson. But my God, God didn't call you to be a copycat. She said, you don't dress like the last evangelist. He sure was a dresser and said, man, he sure did have a program and he sure was a promoter. He said, Ann, and I said, Ann, what? And she said, he sure was. don't want that said about me, but I like when somebody say that was a man said from God.
Yeah.
Said about God. Men said. Men said from God, certain about something. He's certain about the inspiration of the scripture. He's certain about the virgin birth. He's certain about the miracles. He's certain about the resurrection. He's certain about the intercessory work of Christ. He's certain about the freedom in your return of the Lord. Now, honest before God, I believe a man that's mixed up on the second coming is mixed up on everything else in the Bible. He was certain about his uncompromised. I read about Polycarp, who was the pastor of the church at Smyrna. And the next church is the word Pergamus. And they had a preacher by the name of Antipas. And both of them were martyrs. And they burned Polycarp at the stake, and he was 86 years old. And they said, Polycarp said, if you'll repent, you'll not put these faggots around that stake and light that fire. And old Polycarp looked at that crowd, and it was gashing their teeth on him, and that he said, 8 and 6 years have I served him, and not once has he ever denied me, and I'll not deny him now.
Amen.
Amen. Capital of the state of North Carolina is named after Sir Walter Raleigh. I ain't ever put his picture on that old filthy tobacco can. But he's a Christian. He loves God. And they executed him at the guillotine, and the executioner that was standing there about ready to drop the knife in which the server his head from his body looked down in the face of that man of God and said, Mr. Raleigh, your head is not picked right. And that man of God looked up in the face of that executioner and said, sir, if that is not how my head is fixed as long as my heart. And says, from God's courageous. Old John the Baptist had one weapon. He had an axe. He was a root cut. Most people say, oh, you're one of them there negative preachers. Well, my God, there are 4 kinds of prophets in the Bible. First of all, I have Dr. Lake, did you ever hear Joe Henry Hagin? old Joe Henry Hankins used to preach. And I used to call, I had him in my church and in my home. I had old Dr. Bob Jones Sr. in my home. I had old Dr. John Rice in my home, Kepler. I had Charles Weichel in my home, Kepler, for several days. I heard such men as R.G. Lee. I ate breakfast with R.G. Lee 10 years before he died, and I begged him to come out of that awful condition. I said, "You and Principal can do it. You can do it." Killed me. I said, "You ought to have already got it down. You're not preaching all over this land that would have followed you." Old Joe Henry Hankins used to stand up, and I can see him now as he weeps. And he used to hang men over hell. And those old time preachers used to stand up in that pulpit and preach for eternity, bound souls. And they used to lift up their hands. And they used to preach and preach and preach, and sometimes they would preach a month and never give an altar call, and then finally on the last night or last day of the meeting, night after night, they preached, and when they get through preaching, they'd walk over the platform, and they would say, "Go home and sleep in your tent. My God, he had hung over hell." The last day of the meeting, he'd get up there and lift up those old bony hands. He'd call for sinners to come and seek the Lord and plead for the wrath of God to come. 50 or 100 more seeking souls come to that morning, pink, and weep their way to God. Nowadays we give a little old invitation. You come down here and accept Jesus. I'll tell you what I'll do. I'll eat that Bible if you'll show me any place in there where it says for a sinner to accept Jesus. God is a sovereign. He commands men to repent. He commands men to believe. He commands men to receive. We are the subject. He has that right. Last thing about John, John has some conscience. Amazing grace. Now you don't have conscience. One of the reasons why the shepherd carried the oil bag, David said, "Thou anointest my head with oil," is because the sheep get scratches on it. They carried that oil bag for snake bites, parasites, carried that oil bag for sex habits. Put that oil on the heads of the rams so they wouldn't kill each other at the rutting season or the mating season. And they carried that oil bag, had hog's oil in it, and they put it on the sheep for scratches. If you stand for God, you're going to get some scratches. And preachers, you hear me well. And I ain't looking for no meeting. Now, some of these fellows may be looking for something, but I ain't looking. But you'll never be any good for God or any count for God or any count to this world until you get saved from public opinion.
Amen.
Isn't it sad, Dr. Lincoln, that a preacher's worst enemy is another Baptist preacher? That's true. Dr. Lakin said yesterday at the dinner table, he said, "There ain't no need you talking about the convention boys talking about the independents." He said, he told them, he said, "Just leave them alone. They'll kill each other. We fight for them." You know what would be good if we could agree to disagree without being so confounded disagreeable?
Amen.
Well, John the Baptist had conflict. Conflicts are designed for God to make it strong. And every man that's ever been used of God has gone through some conflict. Dr. Slapper, my friend, I remember when his little girl got killed in my home church. He's preaching a meeting at me. He'll tell you, he's here this morning. that he was not the man that he is until that tragedy happened to his life. J. Harold Smith, same thing about that, putting that match in that gas tank and blew his little old boy half into and burned him all up, and he stood there at that hospital listening to that little boy and said, blow me, burning up. Conflicts are designed to make us strong. Well, John the Baptist had conflict from palace there in the Roman. Conflict from politics, the Pharisees, the Sadducees. By the way, the Pharisees were the Democrats of the day, and the Sadducees were the Republicans of the day. And conflict from poverty. And conflict from his preaching to Ted. He took a stand on the vital issues of the day. And there are a lot of preachers that will preach the gospel who refuse to contend for the faith that was once delivered under the faith of God. And you won't meet the pottery if you take a stand against abortion and against the new morality. And that ain't a thing of the God except the old immorality in disguise. You're not to be so popular if you take a stand against a precept and birth control and all that stuff. You won't be so popular. You won't be so popular if you take a stand against the easy believers and the easy receivers of and the National and the World Council of Churches and the Ecumenical Movement. I stand right where I was for 25 years. I had to stand. A friend of mine went down to school where I graduated from, Piedmont, a few months ago. And he graduated in the same class I did in 1946. Dr. Charles Stevens taught us the doctrines of the grace of God. And that friend of mine got up there and preached at the Bible College, and he preached the same message that Charles H. Stevens taught us at Piedmont 30 years ago. And those professors sat there and raised their eyebrows and pulled their glasses down on their nose. And you know what that friend of mine said? He said, "I see how you're looking at me." He said, "I haven't changed in the last 30 years." He said, "If there's been any change in you, all are the ones that's done it." Well, old John the Baptist, he came to town, had on a leather pair of shorts, leather shirt. And to top it all off, he had the bristle part in and the slick part out. Zechariah 13, verse 4 says the prophet of God had to wear the slick part out and the bristle part in. The everyday man, he wore the bristle part out and the slick part in, but not the man of God. You know why? So whenever he got up there preaching, he got the sweat. Old Dr. Bob Jones, used to say, "Preacher ain't worth a hill of beans unless he preaches like he's fighting a swarm of bees and works up a ladder." You know what a ladder is? That's that white stuff under the horse collar. That's a ladder. And when that preacher gets up by preaching and lifts up those holy hands, feet in hell, the other in heaven, and he called on me into his head. He starts sweating. Them old bristles would get to sticking him. It was to remind him that sin was a stick in the nostrils of a holy God. That's why he had to wear the bristle part in. That's the reason for the leather dress. So then it says that his meat was locusts and wild honey. Now, most everywhere I go, they feed preachers chicken. In fact, there's a lady sitting back there, she told me a while ago, she said, "I brought you chicken, gravy, taters, biscuits, the works for dinner." She said, "What you want me to do with it?" I said, "I'll take care of it in just a little bit." But Whenever I go, I mean, they feed the chicken.
You hear about that preacher dropping his teeth in the well? That little boy came up and said, "What's wrong, preacher?" Said, "I dropped my plate in the well and can't get it out." That little boy said, "Hey, wait a minute, preacher, I'll get it out." He runs out, got a chicken leg, ties his string, drops it down in the well, and whenever the chicken leg got to the plate, just grabbed onto it and called it. I don't see nothing wrong with the south end of a northbound cow once in a while. I mean, I preached a meeting in Kentucky a while back, and I ate chicken 21 times in 2 weeks. My God, I ate chicken hot, I ate chicken cold, I ate chicken young, I ate chicken old, I ate chicken tender, I ate chicken dark. But for 1 2 weeks, my God, I ate chicken enough. Came to town eating locusts a mile hunter. Now, he ain't a wild hunter to give him strength. Now, you preachers, if you're going to preach, you got to eat. And that little association of missionaries got upset. Now, we don't want none of these fat, puffled up preachers that fullness of mouth preaching for us. Now, wasn't that nice? He reminds me of little old Seth. He said, the book of Acts, he's a flunky. What do you mean? We don't want none of these fat, puffy, just creatures, foam at the mouth, creatures, and moving. Father said to me, he said, "You just never say, this is how that convention, we're going to shut every door on you, we're going to see that you never preach in another Baptist church." That little old funky that said that to me, he said, "In house trailers." I turned down 5 meetings a week. Now, you can't cut cordwood in these pancakes and oatmeal on special pay. You don't have to eat some sawmill gravy, and you don't have to do some chocolate every once in a while with some Ted-head biscuits and something to stick to your ribs if you want to eat. John, a honey that gave his shreds while he was a preacher. You ever tried to cut cordwood on pancakes? You can eat a steak that high and go out and cut a cornwood, you feel like you're full up for that, and about 10:30 in the morning, you are as empty as a balloon. You're going to need some strength. And you can make money who is 17,000. I read a book one time, Brother Ralph and Brother Mays, and you know what the title of the book was? Preacher, when are you going to preach? God, if a man that claims to be called of God to preach, and he won't preach. These missionaries that come in and say, "We're going to show some slides, and it'll be all right." No wonder you don't get $25 a month support. If you start preaching, you get support. But he ate the locust. When I was in the Holy Land, I didn't know what this meant until I went to the Holy Land. Locust clean. Read this in the book of Leviticus. And they're clean. By the way, there are 4 kinds of locusts in the Bible. I don't have time to deal with that. But locusts, I watched them in Palestine. They cut their heads off and their legs off and gut them a little bit and take a nail and put them up on the board. And put them on the back side of the building so the sun could shine on them. And it would grind, sort of like you dry apples or peaches and make apple pies, moon pies, in the wintertime.
And see, they didn't have any medical know-how in those days. And so therefore, everything that they would cook, everything they would eat, they'd take those grasshoppers, those locusts, and they put them on a rock, grind it up, and then they put it in everything that they would cook and eat. And you know, they discovered that wonder drug called penicillin in locusts. And John ate honey to give him strength, but he ate locusts to keep him healthy. He never had a bad cold in 20 years. Never had any flu. Never had a virus. Slept out under the stars. Slept in caves. Yeah, slept under the dew. He ate locusts and God for 20 years. Gave him a dose of penicillin every day. And he stayed healthy until he got his head cut off. Then you had conversation with prisoners. But in Matthew chapter 11, look at it. This helps me, and I'll be done in a couple of minutes. You don't need to hear the squire say anyway. Johnny passes by the record. Look at chapter 7. Squire's wife told me, she said, at the Jubilee the year before last, she said, you know how come they request Squire to sing the same song over and over and over again? You remember he sang Beautiful Land about 20 times? And they said, sing it again, sing it again, sing it again. Squire sang it about 15 or 20 times. I got up to preach and I said, how come nobody ever requests me to preach the same sermon again? And his wife has got the driest humor any woman I ever run into. And she called me to sit over behind that last pillar. And she said, Brother Canoy, she said, the reason they request the squire to sing the same song over again, and the reason they don't request your sermon over again, says squire's song lasts 3 minutes and your sermon lasts 3 hours. What she said. John got discouraged. And old John gets in jail, and John has some disciples, and he sends his disciples to see Jesus, to find Jesus. And John's disciples go and find Jesus. And Jesus said, hey, where's John? He said, he's sitting down there in jail, all discouraged, head down between his legs, don't know which way to go, what to do. Said he's discouraged, he wants to die. Like Elijah was. When Elijah got to be discouraged, he said, let me die. Now, he didn't want to die, really. He just wanted self-pity. Because if he really wanted to die, don't you imagine Jezebel would accommodate him? Boy, Brother Mays, the next church I organize, the first committee I'm going to organize is a pity committee. God help us, carnal, conceited, confused, stylish, charismatic, bunch of Corinthians today. Old John's discouraged, sitting down in that jail cell, says this, hey, you go find Jesus, and ask him, say, hey, Bobby, preach the truth. Is he really the king, or should I look for another? Have I been preaching there? His disciples go find Jesus, and they tell him. And Jesus said, listen, you go back and you tell John. And he's not a reed growing in. And said, not only that, but he's the greatest man that's ever come out of a woman. And said, not only that, but you tell him the blind receive their sight. The lame's been made to walk. The lepers are cleansed and deaf have been made to hear, and the dead have been raised up, and the poor have the gospel preached unto them. And they go back and they tell John, sitting in that jail cell, and I imagine when old John hears that news, he jumps up off of that jail from where he's sitting in that cell, and he says, hallelujah, my worship God, executioner, come on, here's my hand. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
with me tomorrow morning. I'm going to deal with that. Why did John baptize? Why was Jesus baptized? Why was Jesus circumcised? Why was Jesus kissed? I'll deal with that.